So we're going to get started. Tonight is all about critters. I also want to thank NCTV for filming us. This is going to be available playing multiple times over the next week or two, and then it'll be available in perpetuity on their video on demand function. So go to their website and you can actually look at a link of this. And I'll also provide the PowerPoint to Amy, who will send it out to everyone else. Our very last one will be next week, starting at 5:15, and that will be all about fisheries and the use and abuse of the ocean. We'll talk about energy, about coasts and waves, so I'll present some stuff at the beginning about coastal systems and waves and wave fronts so that we can learn more about that. In the last three sessions, we've covered chemistry, physics, geology, the whole Earth as a whole. And tonight it's going to be all kinds of critters and how they interact with the ocean, the things they need to find in the ocean. So thanks again for being here. It's three different chapters in the textbook Essentials of Oceanography. So chapter 12, Life in the Ocean. So when we look at life, we look at adaptations, and a lot of adaptations can be seen in the ocean. And adaptations come, and evolution guides that, as postulated by Darwin and by Wallace, two different folks that really had a lot to do with how we look at evolution. And basically, you're going to have random mutations that occur. So things grow, they mutate. If the mutation is positive, then you have more of that type of creature, whether it's bigger eyes, eyes farther apart, having an electrical system like fish have, swim bladders. When you look at things in the ocean, they actually are brilliantly adapted to living in the ocean. And they have a lot of special features that we'll talk about tonight. Convergent evolution is when environmental conditions lead to similar adaptations in very different species. And the very next slide will show that to you. So there are examples of creatures that live in different habitats that all have the same kind of evolutionary traits. And that's called convergent evolution. All of these items, the dolphin, the ichthyosaur, shark, and penguin all have a streamlined shape and a foreleg or wing-derived flipper to propel themselves through the water. So here's that example. All on different phylogenetic trees, the difference between dolphins, marine mammals, birds, reptiles, and sharks, and all of them have this fusiform shape, this streamlined shape, with flippers that have been adapted to help propel them forward. So this is called convergent evolution. Now, ocean versus the land. You guys, obviously, we're walking around on land, so the land seems like a more normal habitat to us. The isolation of islands leads to faster evolution. And we're actually seeing this on Nantucket. If you go to the Nantucket Biodiversity Initiative bioconferences, you'll learn about some of the changes we're seeing morphologically and genetically with some of the creatures here. So once a creature gets stranded on an island, they only make babies with each other on that island, typically. And so you're starting to limit the gene pool and you'll start seeing evolutionary changes. Now, one thing that's interesting is the ocean has a lot bigger volume, so there's a lot more space to exchange genetic material, as they say. More ways to make a living in the ocean, too. There's some ways of existence, such as filter feeding, that have no counterparts on land. A tree will filter and get nutrients like carbon dioxide, but there's almost no creature that sits around and waits for things to fall in its mouth on land. It would be kind of counterproductive. But in the ocean, you're dealing with a fluid dynamic. You're dealing with the photoic zone. It's a very different, almost alien landscape. And that's one of the reasons that oceanographers love studying the ocean, is because it's so different than the land. Marine food chains tend to be much more complex than land-based ones. There's a lot more exchanges. Once again, this fluidity lends itself to a lot of different creatures. And so there's lots of jumps in marine food chains. And marine life has evolved to take advantage of every scrap of energy and every bit of food. You think the ocean as being this big giant soup full of creatures and food, but actually a lot of it's a desert. And so sometimes you might be swimming along for days or weeks before you find food. And we'll talk about things like whale falls and other things that become oases for fish and for living things. So oceanic life is classified by evolutionary heritage. When I have lots of friends who are taxonomists, They study biological classifications. You've heard about the lumpers and the splitters. These are people who look at things and then put them in certain categories based on their morphology, on their genetics. There's a natural system of classification, a common natural origin. You've got Linnaeus's kingdoms and hierarchies. And then he invented binomial nomenclature, which is scientific naming. So Linnaeus named probably more creatures than almost anyone else. And he thought of this very systematic way of naming things. DNA analysis, of course, Linnaeus existed long ago, and he didn't have DNA analysis, which has shown that there are three levels that exist above kingdoms. I'm not going to go into great detail unless you guys want to become taxonomists, but there's a lot of complexity in all of this. And you've got three levels above kingdoms: bacteria, archaea, and eukaryotes. Eukaryotes are multi-cells. These are domains. Bacteria and archaea are small, single-celled organisms with no distinct compartments and no cell nucleus. Eukaryotes are multicellular with a nucleus and organelles. I'm sure you all are flashing back to biology going, God, this was the hard part of biology. Much larger cells, animals, plants, fungi, and protists are all eukaryotes, and they can be single-celled or multicelled, but they're more complex cells. Here's those three domains: bacteria, archaea. These don't have a nucleus. They're prokaryotes. Eukaryotes have a nucleus, and that's all of this here. When we think of things, we think of them over here. We don't think about all the life that lives over these two columns. These are, of course, the earliest cells genetically. So one thing that very few people have ever heard of is the archaea, and these are animals that look like bacteria, but actually can use lots of different energy sources. They possess genes. They have metabolic pathways. When you look at these little things, there's no way you would think it would actually have a gene. They have enzymes that help it translate RNA and DNA. They use lots of different energy sources. They might, if we go to Mars, the first type of life we'll find is going to be probably archaea. So they can form things like sugars to, they can convert ammonia, metal ions, or even hydrogen gas. There's salt-tolerant archaea, the heliarchaea that use sunlight as an energy source but can live in salt systems. There's other types of archaea that can fix carbon. Unlike both plants and cyanobacteria, no type of archaea does both. None of them photosynthesize and use other plants for food. And they reproduce asexually through binary fission, fragmentation, or budding. They don't form spores. Archaea are very recent discoveries. They're often called extremophiles. So if you go look at a bubbling, hot salt lake in Yellowstone, and you start filtering out that water, you will find this creature living in the bubbling, sulfurous, very low, acidic, super acidic gunk, and that's going to be archaea. They can be found in soils, marshlands, and we even have some living on us. So in our colon and navel, next time you're looking there, look for archaea. They're really numerous in the ocean, and the archaea and plankton may be one of the most abundant groups of organisms on the planet. So this is a type of organism we didn't even know existed until about 40 or 50 years ago. They play a major part of Earth's life, and they play roles in both the carbon cycle and the nitrogen cycle. So when you talk to biologists that are practicing biology and looking at what would live on other planets, this is the type of life they concentrate on. And here's the whole genetic pathway here. So bacteria, I call archaea's more normal cousin. It can be photosynthetic, chemosynthetic, and heterotrophic, and we'll talk a little bit about those. Typically, they're often decomposers, so they take material other things have made and they break them down for food, because that's a lot easier, right? We can just take stuff other people made and eat it. For nearly 2 billion years, marine bacteria ruled the Earth. During the age of bacteria, from 3.5 to 1.8 million years ago, billion years ago, all of Earth's biogeochemical cycles were established. But for bacteria, Earth's material resources would have been bound into an irretrievable form a long time ago. So they had to start being nature's recyclers. A lot of people don't realize how important this is. If all the bacteria died, we would die. They recapture energy. So this recapturing thing is if something's living It dies, it sinks to the ground. Without microbes, all that energy would be lost. And we would eventually pretty much run down. They help recycle this energy and release carbon and carbohydrates back into the system. Oceanographers now often refer to water column bacteria as bacterioplankton, because plankton kind of have better PR. When people hear the word plankton, they go, oh, that sounds nice. Well, bacterioplankton are plankton, floating organisms that are bacteria. We also have to talk about the fact that they can make their own food. They can also produce their own energy, taking energy and packaging it into food. They can produce organic matter, like primary producers. Photosynthetic bacteria are abound all over the world. When we look at these big blue-green algae blooms, we're looking at cyanobacteria. We're looking at bacteria that can live on metals. And oceanographers estimate that photosynthetic bacteria contribute more to primary production than all of the other primary producers, the little plants that live in the ocean. The bacteria create more production than all of that. So if we're going to adapt to climate change, we're going to have to do it through bacteria. So here is a big long thing that just shows all of these kingdoms, phylums, some phylums, class, order, family, genus, species. This is how you break down animals into different categories. It's long and involved, but just trust me on this. They've changed this a couple of times and they've added subphylum. But here are your different kingdoms, your phylums, your classes, and then it goes all the way down to species. So if you're looking at a fish or a bird, this is how you're going to break it down. You guys would be familiar with all of that. So energy flows through these systems. One of two ways, either we take the energy from the sun, so every time you eat a carrot, you're eating the energy that was packaged by that carrot by using the sun's energy and through photosynthesis creating carbohydrates that we can process. So this is the process used by most producers to convert the sun's energy to food, which when you think about it in an existential manner, it's pretty cool. Chemosynthesis is what we would do if there was no sunlight, and a lot of creatures don't have sunlight or don't use it. So that's production of food from inorganic molecules, basically from chemicals in the environment. And a lot of things are chemosynthesis, synthesizers. So this is the equation that usually makes people cry in school. It's a very simple one though. Carbon dioxide and water, along with sunlight, create carbohydrates and oxygen, photosynthesis. Chemosynthesis is carbon dioxide plus anything here, in this case, hydrogen sulfide. Takes these two combined, the energy from the broken chemical bonds creates carbohydrates and sulfites. So chemosynthesizers use this pathway. Plants, phytoplankton, primary producers use this one. Here's the flow of energy through living systems, light energy, producers, photosynthesizers, algae, green plants, and specialized bacteria. Here's the chemical energy, carbohydrates. Here's the consumers, that's us, respirers, we respire, animals and decomposers and plants at night, we give off CO2. And then here's the energy moving in the form of heat and waste to space. Primary producers synthesize organic materials. So primary producers create grams of carbon bound into organic material per square meter of ocean surface. This is how we can evaluate if there's an algae bloom, how much food is there in the ocean. And there's parts of the ocean with almost no food. Remember, I was talking about deserts. When you are in a beautiful Caribbean area, you can see all the way down to the bottom. There's actually not a whole lot of primary production occurring. What's happening in Nantucket Harbor on any given day has more carbon being produced by primary producers than those beautiful Caribbean waters. So primary producer in the ocean are phytoplankton. They produce 90 to 96% of the surface ocean's carbohydrates. Seaweeds and chemosynthetic organisms account for the rest. So when we see, you know, the green color in the harbor and a river, that we're looking at algae, phytoplankton specifically. Primary producers, it occurs in water, in seabed sediments, and even in solid rock. Those extremophiles I was mentioning earlier, bacteria and archaea, live under extreme conditions, are another creator of energy. So here's the sunlight, here's a meter, here's CO2, here's this diatom, and here's sugar. Pretty amazing. Ocean primary productivity in the water column will create or bind 120 grams of carbon into molecules of glucose each year. One of the things we're trying to do is increase this number to fight climate change, because we have too much CO2, right? So the ocean is really a good way, probably the only way, to absorb that excess CO2. Though some scientists are even looking at injecting CO2, carbon dioxide, underground. So here is a chart that shows this is 0 grams of carbon per meter squared per year. We're measuring how much food is created per meter squared per year. So it's a nutrient flux per year. This is a coral reef. Here's 0 to 2500. Here's a kelp bed. Here's shelf plankton. Open ocean is way down here. Is it 1 to 180? Here's land communities. Here's a rainforest. So your coral reef and your kelp bed are a lot higher than your rainforest. Here's temperate forest. Here's a freshwater swamp. A marsh would be pretty close to coral reef. It would be right about there. And here's cropland, which can vary depending on how good a farmer you are. So farmers here, over here, bad farmers down here. Here's a primary productivity chart of the whole ocean. This is done through satellite imaging. The red, yellow, and green areas indicate high primary productivity. Blue areas indicate low primary productivity. So all of this is, in effect, almost deserty. Up here, there's a lot of fresh water and a lot of nutrients, so this is very productive, this is pretty productive, and right along the coast. This is all the primary, and here's along the equator with heat and nutrients and upwelling. Remember, we were talking about upwelling, you'll have big bursts of really productive area. So everyone's heard of a food web and a food chain. They disperse energy through these different creatures, autotrophs, organisms that make their own food, autotroph, make their own food, heterotroph, organisms that have to eat other organisms for food. If only we were autotrophs. If you read a lot of science fiction, there's a lot of cool stories about creatures that are our size that are autotrophs, but we're not them. Trophic pyramid is the model that shows who eats who. Primary consumers are the organisms that are the first ones to eat the heterotrophs and autotrophs. Secondary consumers are the next level up, and then top consumers. We're top consumers. I'm going to show you this in three different visual ways. And each time you jump a trophic level, it's usually about 10% of the energy is converted. So here's your primary producers, phytoplankton, 10,000 kilograms, makes 1,000 kilograms of small herbivores. So here's your phytoplankton. So it takes 10 times this to make this weight, 10 times this to make 100 kilograms of small fish, 10 times that to make 10 kilograms of big fish, and each of that is 1 kilogram of tuna, which we would use, hopefully not a whole kilogram of tuna for a tuna sandwich, but we would take all of that and put it into, let's say, 50 tuna sandwiches. Well, a quarter pound, actually not 50 tuna sandwiches, more like about 5. So that's a lot of energy being displaced. That's why when you're discussing how to be more efficient people on the planet, tuna might not be the route you take. Here's that same thing at 1 to 10 to 100 to 1,000. Here's the plants, animals. That's why they say eating lower on the food pyramid is better for the planet. Each of those are lost energy. So those primary producers are losing energy at 10%. Here's a quote-unquote simplified food web. It's your primary producers, your consumers, more consumers. You've got microbes that are recycling, mainly poop. So all these things poop, right? When they poop, that's carbon that somebody didn't use. It doesn't seem like that when you're cleaning it, but that's what it is. And the microbes are harvesting that carbon and putting it back into the system. So these kind of environmental factors influence the success of marine organisms. Any physical factor like temperature, light, dissolved gases, the acidity, the salinity, the hydrostatic pressure, or even dissolved nutrients are considered physical factor. A limiting factor is a factor found that's either too low or too high. If it's too much sunlight, sometimes that can bleach things. There's too much heat that can keep things from, in some cases, growing. In the case of a pond, you usually have phosphate as a limiting factor. So if you add more phosphate, algae grows. In the ocean, it's typically nitrate. Nitrate is in the lowest quantity in relationship to what could be used. Biological factors are things like active transport, surface to volume ratio, and we'll talk about that a whole lot, osmosis and diffusion. Most things are actually abiotic. So photosynthesis, you'll remember this from our first class, Photosynthesis depends on light. Here's your red light and yellow light getting absorbed. Green light's making it down further, but blue light makes it down the deepest. That's why the oceans are blue. Here is in mid-latitude water, extends down to 150 meters. In coastal water, it might only be down to 100 meters. So this is much deeper. Photosynthetic depth is deeper in mid-latitude waters in those big blue zones because there's less algae clouding the water. Photosynthesis depends on light. So photosynthesis occurs up here. Here you can see, but there's not enough vision, and there's not enough sunlight to photosynthesize, and here you can't do any, you can't see or make food. So all the creatures need to stay up here. So they have all kinds of methods for staying up there. They make themselves big and flat. They make themselves really light so that they can stay up here. Or they depend on currents, on the kindness of strangers to pull them back up into the photosynthetic zone. This is called the euphotic zone. Below this is dysphotic, so with light, without light. And then this is aphotic. I know it's a lot of stuff. We'll get to it all. You'll absorb more than you think. Now you've got a metabolic rate, and that increases with temperature. It approximately doubles for every 10 degrees Celsius. Most marine organisms are ectothermic, cold-blooded. They're very dependent on their external surroundings for their metabolic rate. A few creatures can, but a lot of creatures that live in the ocean can't really control their temperature. Mammals, birds, and a few fishes are endothermic, which are warm-blooded. Not all fishes, but some fishes, meaning they maintain a constant and high temperature. And here is in Fahrenheit and in Celsius, daytime temperatures typical. So surface temperatures in low Arctic are about 5 degrees, subtropical 20. This shows all the temperatures. I'm going to move through these next two quickly. You've got diffusion, osmosis, isotonic. Things that live in the water have to be able to handle the density of salt that's in that water. So you've got a different concentration of materials inside and outside those cells. If they can't handle it, all the water in the sea will actually enter their cells and they'll explode. Active transport is the transport of a substance across a concentration gradient. It's a way of expelling things. It requires energy. Here's an example of diffusion that you guys all know, water, a dye cube in 20 days. All of these molecules have bounced around until they're all in the exact same distance from each other. So marine organisms live in communities. You've got a community which is many populations of organisms that interact in a particular location, like Nantucket. You have a population of humans on Nantucket, or populations of humans on the planet. This is a group of organisms of the exact same species. So you could talk about a population of herring gulls, but it has to be the exact same species. A habitat, which is probably one of the most important things to conserve when you want to protect populations, and community is the habitat, and that's where everything lives. And then the niche is what an organism does in its habitat, what it eats, how it avoids enemies. Every creature on the island, every creature in the sea has its own niche or niche. When somebody moves in that's invasive, sometimes it pushes out other creatures, like the red-eared slider will come and overtake a painted turtle's niche or niche. But competition's good. If we all had it easy, well, then life would be too easy. So organisms in a community compete with members of the same species or similar species and with members of other species for food, light, space, and other resources. You've seen the plants in your home fight each other for sunlight, for instance. Two populations of different organisms can't be in the same niche in the same community long term. Somebody will end up getting booted out, as we see all the time. Marine environments are classified based on whether they are open water or pelagic. The neritic zone is near shore over the continental shelf. The oceanic zone is beyond the continental shelf. So both of these are pelagic, near shore and offshore, but they're in the water versus the benthos. The benthic part is the bottom. And the bottom has a lot more terms: littoral or intertidal, sublittoral, beyond the littoral zone. Bathyal is when you're starting to get really deep, like, you know, bathos. Abyssal zone is below the bathyal zone, and hadal zone is all the way down in a trench. Here's each of these zones. Here's your benthic zone, here's your pelagic zone, and here's your photic layers. So this has actually got a ton of good information here. So pelagic communities occupy the open ocean. They're swimming around or floating around, everything from mola mola to an anglerfish to octopi. The productivity varies with local conditions. Most productive in areas with high levels of nutrients. If there's a lot of food, you're going to get algae blooms. You're going to have more production. Highest near continents because we get nutrients from runoff. And we have nutrients that are upwelled. So your highest productivity is typically near a continent. Tropical waters are very clear because they have few phytoplankton. Zooplankton or zooplankton, I always like calling them zooplankton, everybody has their own. They eat phytoplankton. So zooplankton or zooplankton implies that it's a creature, a critter, not just a plant. Quickly going to, plankton just means free floating. So you could actually consider things like jellyfish plankton. When people think of plankton, they always think of the tiny plankton, but there's big things that are planktonic. Holoplankton spend their whole lives as plankton. Meroplankton spend part of their lives as either benthic or nectonic. So, you know, there's lots of creatures that change from being planktonic to being sessile to being able to swim. Scallops, a good example. They're going from spat, where they're planktonic, to, you know, the veliger, to spat, to the small scallop that will live on eelgrass, to the bigger scallop that can self-propel. Here's examples of other things that spend part of their life in these different categories, copepods, arthropods, and forams. Plankton can't really move very well laterally. We'll see some dinoflagellates and stuff that can spin around, and they can kind of move, but they're not known for their movement. Some of them can move vertically. Very few of them can move this way. They're very diverse in number and types of species. They depend on predation, parasitism, and competition. Most phytoplankton are photosynthetic autotrophs that make their own food. These are the top three or four most famous diatoms, the dominant and most productive of the photosynthetic plankton. Dinoflagellates, this is what we see if we get a red tide. These are widely distributed single-cell phytoplankton. They use flagella. Flagellates means little whips to move. Coccolithophores are single-celled autotrophs. They're beautiful. I'll show you tons of pictures of all of these. And then picoplankton are teeny tiny, and they encompass most other types of plankton, which are very small. If you're taking a whole class, you get to memorize. When we go out and take samples, we're going to use a plankton net. So we're going to drive along in the water column. This is a big plankton net. We use a little one that any of us could hold. We just go under power for 10 minutes, pull up the cup or the cod end, and that's where all the plankton is. And you would be shocked to see how much plankton is out there right now. If we all jumped on a boat and dragged this net and brought it aboard, it would blow your mind, especially with all the sunlight we've had this week. Tons. So here's a type of cyanobacteria along with Cinococcus. These are tiny, tiny picoplanktons. These are able to absorb dim blue light, so they can live very deep down in the euphotic zone. Oh, and that's a picture. Oh, that's what I see what I'm doing. Didn't realize this was it. Oh, so excited. Here's the microbial loop. We talked a little bit about this versus the official food chain. Here's the regular food chain. The microbial loop takes food out at these different levels and recycles it. We'll be able to see that more in a second. A ciliate is a type of bacteria that we can see, and it filters a huge amount of water. It's another name for one that you would recognize as paramecium. They can filter all the bacteria from 50 microliters of water in an hour. This is equivalent to 10 to 50,000 bacteria. There's tons of them. Bacteria are scavengers. They eat marine snow. I'll show you some marine snow. They're patchy. They use a random walk. If you like physics, this is a really cool. So bacteria just randomly wander about, and that's how they find food. They actually randomize their motion. They secrete enzymes to break down the larger organic molecules. That's how they can digest it. They can double 1 to 10 times a day, and they're present in 10 million to a billion cells per liter. Some bacterivores are, that means they're bacteria eaters, or flagellates. Anything that eats bacteria are called bacterivores. There's tons of them in the ocean, and they occur at high densities. We'll see some pictures. This is the forams. There's a lot of forams probably over there in that fossil. These are single-celled, made of calcium carbonate. They form, Globigerina oozes on the seafloor. They're bigger than ciliates or flagellates. So I'm taking you through each major type of phytoplankton size by size. So we're going bigger and bigger. Some of them look like teeny tiny snails, and a lot of them have fake feet called pseudopodia. They have a symbiotic relationship with dinoflagellates. They're mixotrophic, they can eat other organisms or sunlight. And they can transport symbionts to the end of their pseudopods. So they can take a symbiont and kind of carry it around and then flush it to the end of their feet and use their pseudopods and the symbiont to make food and then bring it to their mouth. So if there was ever such thing as a robot phytoplankton, it'd probably be the forams. These guys, most marine biologists that study fossils study forams, and there are hundreds of people where this is all they study. It's their only thing. This is what one looks like, blown up about 9 million times. They have these little windows that light can show through. Here's some other forams. See how the different beautiful, beautiful assemblages, beautiful shapes. They're designed not to sink. Here's which forams are found when in the geologic time. That's how you use forams to date rocks. Here are benthic forams on the left, planktonic ones on the right. The benthic ones tend to be long and skinny. These are spectacular, but most of them look like snails in this thing. And then here, they're more globular. The next class of famous phytoplankton are radiolaria. They're made of silicon dioxide, which is an ingredient of glass. And it's also found in quartz. They're beautiful, they have long radia. They're common in tropical and subtropical oceans. They come in wide range of sizes, from 50 microns to a few millimeters, so they're pretty big. They're similar to forams, they're in doubling time, and they're pseudopods and may contain symbionts. Look how beautiful these guys are. This is all drawings from the Challenger. Remember we were talking about how many water samples they took from the Challenger? Somebody looked at each one of these under a microscope and then drew these. Amazing. And this is what they look under a scanning electron microscope. And this is when you actually get a true color version. This is what they look like alive in true color. Gorgeous, gorgeous creatures. Diatoms, we all study diatoms. This is what a variety of diatoms would look like. They're very common. They can control a lot of what happens in the coastal areas. They originated during or before the Jurassic. They're often used to monitor environmental conditions. They're used in studies of water quality. If we see a lot of diatoms, sometimes that tells us something's happening with the nutrients. Here's a great scanning electron microscope picture showing a coccolithophore with some diatoms around it. So this is living together. This is a hole in this diatom, allows it to pass gases, nutrients, and waste products through this silica or glass covering. Here's one more version of that same thing zoomed in. So that's basically this part of it zoomed in even higher. Look at the holes in this, how perfectly they're shaped. This is to allow gas and nutrients to go into the creature's body. Here is a dinoflagellate, two flagellas. This thing spins around. These things are really cool looking. Under a microscope, you're like, oh my God, I can't believe that's a phytoplankton. What's not cool looking is when they form red or rust tides. So a lot of the harmful algal blooms we see are caused by dinoflagellates. They tend to over-reproduce when there's too much nitrate or phosphate. They're just fast responders, it's not their fault. But they can be a problem. Here's an electron micrograph of a coccolithophore. And this is all the calcium plates. I always include this just because when I look out at the ocean, I'm thinking about some of these guys. I mean, not personally one by one, but as in how beautiful they are. Here is a big coccolithophore bloom south of Ireland in this natural color satellite map. So you've got all of these river systems coming off of here and it's causing a bloom of coccolithophores, usually which are not a problem. Diatoms, dinoflagellates can be, coccolithophores are usually not a problem. Here's once again showing those areas where phytoplankton are going to bloom. These things contribute to the sediments. So those two fossils I have over there, one of those is a ooze that's got larger bivalves in it, but it's got hundreds of millions of coccolithophores and diatoms in that clay. So sediments, this is something I skipped on the very first day that I'm coming back to quickly. Sediments can be four types: terrigenous, coming from Earth, 45%, biogenous, coming from organic creatures, hydrogenous, made in place, cosmogenous, made coming from space, or allogenetic, generated somewhere else. Could be all but hydrogenous above. I'm going to skip this, but this will be in the PowerPoint, just talks about different versions of these. So marine sediments are usually combinations of both land and biogenetic deposits. On continental shelves, you're going to have sand, clay, all kinds of broken down rocks. Pelagic sediments, deep ocean floors are primarily biologic. So all those phytoplankton are growing away. One day they're going to die, sometimes 24 hours, maybe to the old age of 72 hours, and they're going to sink to the bottom. Thousands of years later, you'll have 2 miles thick of ocean mud that's made of these creatures. In areas where there's radiolaria, it's going to be more quartz-like or silicon. It'll be basically like glass. In areas where there's calcium carbonate, and you've got more diatoms and other calcium carbonate guys, then it's going to be all calcium carbonate. Here's the thickness in meters. Look how thick this is. It can get up to 5,000 meters thick. So this corresponds, right, to areas right along the continents or areas of high primary productivity. And right along here on the equator, in these primary, see the areas right off of all of the major rivers? Much thicker. I did some research here and found it was 22 centimeters per year of sediment building up. This map shows all of the different types of sediments underlying here and shows what type of creatures are more predominant. So a geological oceanographer, when they took sediment samples, would look for these different creatures. This is showing the calcium carbonate depth. This is a depth at which below this depth the shells would dissolve. And so this is all in the shallow parts of the ocean along mid-ocean ridges. And this is where the different phytoplankton don't dissolve because they're so shallow. Okay, now we're jumping from phytoplankton to things like us. With single cells, we think of doubling times. One creature becomes two, becomes four, becomes eight. Multicellular organisms have gonads. They produce asexually or sexually. And we track these over generations. The most abundant herbivore in the ocean is the copepod. This is every oceanographer's favorite creature. They eat phytoplankton and they have more mass than any other animal on the planet. So if there was a supreme being and they took all the animals on the planet and they put them into bins, the biggest bin mass-wise would be copepods. Copepods are little crustaceans. They're cousins to shrimps, crabs, and lobsters. Most common copepod in the ocean is the calanoid copepod. And you guys might have even seen, there's a couple, this is actually a crab napoli or crab larvae. Copepods and crabs and all kinds of things go through lots of stages and molts because they're crustaceans. They can't get bigger unless they molt. So each of these larva stages tends to look very different. There are 5 copepodid stages before the adult stage. They can use their antenna to sense predators and prey. They can slow themselves down by kind of paddling. And they can also use their antenna for locomotion. This sounds disgusting, but it's true. Their fecal pellets are widely studied. There are oceanographers that just study copepod poop. That's all they do. And are one of the most important ways to transport organic matter into the ocean. So if we want to fix or fight or adapt to climate change, we got to get even more copepods doing their thing and pooping. And that will get more carbon because it's the biggest mass creature. They're the biggest conveyor belt for carbon. Their shells are made of chitin, like many crustaceans have shells that are very similar to our fingernails. And it's a carbohydrate made from cellulose and other lignans in the system. So here's what a traditional calanoid copepod. Have you guys seen one of these, perhaps? They're long and skinny, they've got big antenna, they're very cute, they kind of putter around like little propellers in the water. They have bodies that look like a little lobster, right? They can go up and down. Typically, they're going to go they'll migrate to the surface at night and they'll drop down in the daytime, which seems to be antithetical to what we would think. You would think, oh, daytime, let's go up into the sun. But the sun is actually too hot for these guys, so they usually migrate down. And that's what the phytoplankton they're eating do too. So I didn't know that phytoplankton and these creatures moved up and down until I took oceanography. I thought everything in the ocean just kind of floated around and did its thing. Here's a really beautiful scanning electron microscope picture of one.
How big?
They're small, like 150 microns, but big for phytoplankton. You could see one. People were asking me what you could see. If you had it in a drop of water and were looking really closely, you could see some of the bigger ones. It'd be tough, but you'd really want a dissecting microscope, though. And if you see it underneath a compound microscope, this is what it's going to look like. Here is something that's a meroplanktonic. This is a sea urchin. So when we think of all the cool things that live on the bottom of the ocean, almost all of them lived as plankton for some part of their life. This one's one of my favorites. It'll eventually settle down and become benthic. Oops, did I skip something? Krill. Krill are the second most important thing other than copepods. They look like little shrimp. They're 1 to 5 centimeters in length. You can definitely see krill. When you think of things like sea monkeys, those are krill. Their shells are also made of chitin. Generational periods 30 to 120 days. They feed on phytoplankton. Their fecal pellets are heavier, so they fall even faster. So there are literally cups all over the ocean collecting krill poop. They travel in swarms because things like whales are out to get them. And they vertically migrate in the water column. This is what a krill looks like. Very shrimp-like. They rival copepods in biomass. They're the next thing down. Way more krill than people. Dominant zooplankton in the southern ocean, common food of baleen whales. There's another very famous krill. It's more than twice its actual size. In the book, it was twice its actual size. It would be really scary if this was the actual size. Most marine biologists have krill, you know, like weather vanes and stuff. They're pretty popular. They're herbivores, so they're the cows of the sea. 5 years or more, they live a long time for a marine creature. The total weight of all Antarctic krill is more than the total weight of all humans on Earth. We think krill stocks have dropped by 80% since the 70s, and we think this is due to declined ice cover. A lot of krill live under the ice. This ice loss removes a primary source of food for krill, ice algae. So that's what krill eat. Tenophores. We see thousands of tenophores in the harbor every summer. Typically, Leedy's comb jellies. These are the sea grapes, the things that look like jellyfish that aren't, are tenophores. They bioluminesce. They have two different types of prismatic lights. They have both a beautiful green light and then a rainbow light. So when that sea snot, that kids, remember you put it into a bucket, it's got 5 radiating, I love them, they're my favorites. So their plates move in sequence, they don't have stinging cells, so they can't hurt you. Here's a tenophore in our lab in a container of water. See these little pink lines? These links, definitely go to these links. And let's see what time it is. I don't think we have time. No, we have to skip ahead. After we're done, I'll come back to this slide and show you one of these links. So they have both beautiful rainbow light, beautiful, and beautiful flashes of light too. Oh, I'm tempted, but I'll come back. Here's a picture of some tenophores. And here is a larger sea wasp that you don't want to hurt you. This would really hurt. It lives near Africa and in Northeast Australia, and it can kill a human in 3 minutes. These guys have been responsible for more human deaths than sharks, but they don't get their own week on the Discovery Channel. But this is a good way of looking at what a tenophore looks like, and you can see them anytime you want out in the harbor, well, in July, probably right now would be a bad time. There would be a few out there, though. Here's marine snow, and marine snow, I've got 2 videos for you guys to look at when you're watching this PowerPoint. So when I send it out to you guys, definitely click on these links, and it's beautiful movies of marine snow falling through. Actually, we'll click on one now. Let's hope it works. Yes, it does, and then I gotta see how to show it to you. Oh, poop. Oh, I can see it really well here, but I don't know how to do the flipping of the screen. Okay, so I'll keep moving along. make sure to click on those. Both of those are working. So they show a scientist using an AUV, an autonomous underwater vehicle, to collect marine snow. And you can see these particles falling just like snow in the water column. And when you go down in Alvin, you go down in this rain of marine snow. And it's all of these dead detritus and particles. So it is transporting all of the carbon and detritus down to the seafloor to build up those big globigerina oozes and radial area oozes. So one of the things that we're going to show you also can be found on Nantucket. I'm going to show you the picture and then tell you what it is. So this is a salp chain. Do you guys remember seeing these out at Brant Point in the last couple of years? Looks like a giant disc of jelly. This is my hand. You can tell because I'm wearing rings. It's tons and tons of little clear gelatinous creatures all living together in a big disc. And they're salps. And they are a major part of the food chain. They show up probably in July and August. They are thalassians, or pelagic tunicates, cousins to sea squirts. They're barrel-shaped. You can separate them out. They're just little squares of, it looks like a candy, frankly. They lay side by side with all their siphons pointing in one direction. They're gelatinous. They're common in southern ocean and tropical and subtropical waters, and we'll get huge swarms. Enough where fishermen will start calling me and going, is this a problem? So we had bunches of them wash up. So this is probably 150 creatures. If I took that all apart, each one of them would like be a little chiclet size clear creature. 2014 Brant Point. Here's a little salp right here. See, that's one all by itself. Cute, huh? And great food. It's basically, I can digest that. Any creature could digest that. Not a lot of bones, so this is just carbohydrates just floating around ready to be eaten, probably by tenophores and by small fish. We also get these appendicularians. These are another type of pelagic tunicate. They have a gelatinous house that they then exude. There's a really cool, great movie at this link. And when they get tired of the house, they just get rid of it and build a new one. Here are some famous denizens. There's another great link here. These are called pteropods. They're sea butterflies. Some have shells and some don't. They are really, really tiny, but you should definitely look at the links. The way they float through the water is really, really pretty. So jellyfish are not really filter feeders. They're kind of filter feeders. They're kind of phytoplankton. They're members of the family Cnidaria. They have a bowl-shaped bell that includes internal organs. They propelled themselves through the sea by pumping water through that bell. They use stinging cells called nematocysts that are stored inside nematocytes. These things can still sting you way after they're dead, so they're just like a trigger. So the animal still has all these triggers. And so don't poke them on the beach. It's always been strange to do that anyway. I've written 3 articles on jellyfish, and they're pretty interesting. We have some cool ones here. I've been seeing a lot of lion's manes, I'll get there eventually, floating around. And we even see those in wintertime. So Necton, I'm going to change gears here in a bit, and at the end, if we've got time, I'll shut off this slideshow and pull up some of these movies. They're active swimmers. So on a good day, we're all nectons, right? Most of them are vertebrates. We've got vertebrae. Some of them are mollusks, squids and octopuses, arthropods, fishes, sea turtles, marine crocodiles, and marine mammals. So when we think of an active swimmer, when we think of fish in the ocean, we're normally thinking of nekton, not plankton. Plankton are carried by currents, wind, and a little bit of their flagellas and ciliates. Here's one that we see all the time, squid and cuttlefish, which are mollusks, birds, marine species, penguins. All of these guys are marine predators. Top predators, of course, are large sharks and the large toothed whales. Here's a predator, a chitinath, or an arrow worm. It's about the size of a copepod. It's got a long tail, and they vertically migrate, and you can find them at this blog right there. Here's a famous member that we see, not this size or we'd all freak out, but these are the giant squid, cephalopodas. They're in the order Toothata, which has two major suborders. And here's a version of a giant squid. I don't know if you guys ever saw that on the Discovery Channel. And they spent quite a long time. They thought that this didn't exist, but they would see sperm whales coming up with giant squid tentacle marks. And they're like, well, somebody's doing that. And it's taken us years and years to try to find a giant squid. But there's a few examples in a couple of museums, but they tend to just completely turn to goo when you bring them on board a ship. They don't preserve well. Here is a torpedo ray that we actually dissected at the field station probably about 8 or 9 years ago. Chimeras, sharks, skates, and rays have cartilaginous skeletons. Their skeletons are made of cartilage. I had to figure out what this was the hard way by actually dissecting. And I'm like, well, I don't find any bones, so it's got to be not a bony fish. So this is a cartilaginous fish. Bony fish have bones, hence the bone name. For filter feeding, gills have gill rakers that filter out the food. Some fish eat phytoplankton. Some fish can live to be 100 to 200 years old. So this is kind of like a shark mixed with a flounder. This was about this big, 120-pound female. That's actually her egg sac out there. This is they generate electricity. They can shock the you-know-what out of you. So they used to be called cramp fish, and Romans would use them for treating people when they were sick. They would take you to the shoreline and try to find one of these and make it shock you to fix you. They're only found in deep water, but we've been having one or two wash up every other year on Nantucket. They're not often seen, so it's kind of interesting. Torpedo rays. The torpedo was actually named after the torpedo ray, not vice versa. So all the other fish that we see are bony fishes, and they're most abundant and successful fishes. You get your mola mola, your rays, your redfish, your all of this. About 90% of all living fishes are contained within this order that I can't possibly pronounce, which contains cod, tuna, halibut, goldfish, and other species. Fishes are successful because of their adaptations. They can move through water. They can propel themselves. Water is much more dense and viscous than air, so they have to be pretty strong. They have to maintain their buoyancy, so fish tissue is usually denser than the surrounding water, so fish must have a system to keep it from sinking. If you put a fish in water, it's going to sink unless it's got gas built up in it. So fish must deal with the problem of extracting oxygen from water, and they also have to have feeding and defense adaptations because competitive pressure amongst a large number of fish has caused a wide variety of feeding habits. Here is their gill rakers, so they're actually able to extract oxygen. They basically have almost a turbo system where they're running air through their gills twice, and they're able to extract twice as much oxygen as we could through their gill rakers. Some marine birds are the world's most efficient flyers. There's 270 of the known species of birds qualify as seabirds, so you've got birds that live at sea and real seabirds. Most of the birds we see are really seabirds and not just, pretenders. The tubinoses are the albatrosses and petrels. Pelicans include, I just came back from Texas and got to see the white and brown pelicans. These guys have webbed feet and throat pouches. Seagulls, we all know what seagulls are, and penguins. They don't fly, but they're great swimmers. Here's your requisite picture of a top predator, great white shark, eating some sea lion. Marine mammals include the largest animals ever to have lived on Earth. So the three types of marine mammals are cetaceans, carnivores, and sirenas. Sirenas are manatees and dugongs. The carnivora are the seals, sea lions, walruses, and sea otters. And the cetaceans are your porpoises, dolphins, and whales. You've also got pinnipeds that are in there. Whales are baleen whales, tooth whales. We all know about whales. They can dive. They're very smart. They're found in all the world's oceans, common most in polar areas and temperate seas. Their generational time is 4 to 11 years. The whales can live over 100 years, as anyone who's read things like Moby Dick knows. Here's the different representatives of the cetaceans, all of the pilot whales down to the porpoises. Here's all of your right whales to your blue whale. Here's your pygmy right whale. Of these, I'd say most, about half of them we see around Nantucket. And then here's the size of this blue whale compared to a human, a child, an African elephant, and the apatosaur, like the brontosaurus. baleen. We've got a little bit of baleen in our at the field station that we've tested for radionuclides to figure out how old it is. Whales, of course, use baleen to filter out all that krill. Last thing, benthic organisms. These guys live on the ocean floor. They can be shallow, deep, warm or cold. We've got kelp beds, coral reefs, rocky intertidal zones, our famous eelgrass, and hydrothermal vent communities. Benthic organisms aren't just spread out randomly. I mean, sometimes they are, but there's three different ways they can be spread out: randomly, clumped, or in uniform distribution, like trees in an orchard. Clumped is when you see things close to areas where there's food or water. Random means things that are just spread out and just settle completely randomly. This is actually really important when you're looking at things in the benthos. So when you're going out and sampling them, you have to determine if they're random, clumped, or completely uniform. Seaweeds and marine plants are diverse and very effective primary producers. So if it's attached autotroph, autotroph means it makes its own food, there are forms of proteins called algae or seaweed. There's a lot of discussion between what's an algae and what's a seaweed. Though photosynthetic seaweeds are technically not plants, they're different enough from vascular plants to be classified as protease. So their algae are not put in the plant family. Seaweeds are classified based on pigment type. Somebody asked me about rhodophyta the other day. These are red, phaeophytas are brown, chlorophytes are green. We get all three of them here on Nantucket. Seaweeds can be all kinds of shapes. They don't grow outside of the euphotic zone. 7,000 species. They can be unicellular. You could consider a diatom or a dinoflagellate a seaweed in a way, or multicellular like brackweed and sea lettuce that we see. We see when you're looking out on the harbor, often you're looking at seaweeds. They don't have to deal with drought, usually have plenty of carbon dioxide. They're lightweight, almost the same density as salt water. They use gas bladders. You've seen that Irish rock wort and stuff has those little gas bladders to keep themselves in the photic zone. They don't need to have conductive vessels. Their leaves are blades. Their stems are called stipes. The roots are holdfasts. And they combine to form the thallus or body of a seaweed. I have a friend of mine that works out of Bodega Bay that does pressings of seaweeds that he sells for like $1,000 each. They're amazing. Here's your gas bladder. Here's your blade. Here's your holdfast. Not all of them have holdfast, but most do. Here's your stipe, and this is your traditional kelp. Here is a mangrove. It's not necessarily a seaweed, but it is a benthic plant that can maintain itself underwater in the Everglades. Here's the distribution of kelp beds and mangrove communities around the world, most of them in warm areas near upwelling or near areas where there's lots of nutrients. Here is a picture of our meadow on a good day. Eelgrass, Ostara marina, is a flowering plant. It's not an algae. It's one of the most interesting plants in the world, and we have it right here. So it both can reproduce through budding and cloning, and also through vegetative growth, and it can also reproduce through flowering. So it's an underwater flowering plant. Provides nursery habitat, protective cover, and acts as a substrate for benthic organisms. And I have a little thing that you can click on here that'll tell you a lot about eelgrass. Eelgrasses and marsh grasses, here's a big area of marsh here. This is part of an estuarine marsh. This is a system that is salty at one end and fresher at the other. A lot of pelagic fish, deep water fish, depend on salt marshes and estuaries to have as nurseries, to get food and to hide out. So anything that comes in here and swims has to be able to handle a large range of salinities. Something we don't have a lot of, but I wanted to tell you about, are rocky intertidal communities. When we teach the class, where would we go to look at a rocky intertidal community? Where would you go?
Maine.
Maine, but if you're on Nantucket, where would you go?
Jetties,
yeah. So you'll see our students out there on the low tide, walking way out in the end of the jetties, which is really the only rocky intertidal that we have. You've got sessile and motile. Sessile means, sedentary, and motile means moving, creatures. Problems with intertidal is it has to handle wave shock, desiccation. You've seen those acorn barnacles They can handle being dry for 12 to 13 hours. Temperature fluctuations, usually the temperature change is 30 to 40 degrees. Exposure to predators, you're out stuck on a rock, anything can eat you. Osmotic shock, if you have a big storm and have a lot of rainwater, that can shock creatures that live in the ocean because they're not used to it. And the nice thing is though, you're stuck on a rock, you've got something to hang on, you've got food coming to you with every tide, so it's actually a pretty good way to live once you get past the osmotic shock. So here's an example of when people study rocky intertidal areas, they'll look at the exposure rates and the desiccation rate, and everything is going to form in zones based on how much it can stand being out of the water or how much it can stand being underwater. Next time you're in a rocky intertidal, go and look at it, and you're going to see more of the algae and the green plants way up here. You're going to see an area that is dominated by some red algae typically here. Then you'll have mussels and gooseneck barnacles. And then you're going to have sea stars and anemones. So next time you're taking your kids out to a tidal pool, think about what you're looking at. And each creature that you're looking at is living in that area because of the amount of time it's covered by water. It's called zonation. We have a lot of creatures, benthic creatures, that very few people talk about that burrow in the coastal area. We've got our lovely mole crabs and sand crabs. Are things that are living in the intertidal area and in the sand up all the way up to the high tide. You've got your bean clams, your tardigrades, these are little water bearers. These are all interstitial animals. They live in between the sand grains. So when you look at a beach or an area that's bordering a coastal area, there's lots of creatures that live in that. All of these guys have to be able to handle lots of human disturbance. In fact, they've measured beaches that are often driven on. And usually the biodiversity goes down by about 75%, and several creatures like tiger beetles never come back. But some things can handle being driven on. We drive on the beaches with the mole crabs, and you'll see all kinds of other clams and other creatures. So that's a habitat people don't think about. Coral reefs are very famous. I'm running through, as you can see, all kinds of benthic creatures. Corals are like sea anemone and jellyfish. Each animal is a colony, it's a polyp. It's got this calcium carbonate exoskeleton. It uses tentacles to capture plankton, which it then makes their slaves and inserts into their hermatypic bodies. So they've got these symbionts, these specialized dinoflagellates. They recycle nutrients. Deep water corals don't have dinoflagellates, and they grow really a lot slower, and they're not as exciting, so they're called ahermitic. Coral animals provide safety, CO2 and nutrients. The dinoflagellates help raise the pH to enhance calcium carbonate absorption while providing oxygen and carbohydrates. The dinoflagellates need light and warmth. Freshwater shock can be lethal. Freshwater rivers and suspended sediments keep reefs from growing. Reef corals grow best in brightly lighted water, 5 to 10 meters in depth, and they're found in the 21 degrees Celsius water, isotherm around 25 latitude. Off of Texas is one of the highest and coolest coral reefs. There's one that's right off of Galveston, well, about 100 miles. But here's your distribution of coral reefs, and pretty much in that 25 zone, 0 to 25 north and south. And then you've got your solitary corals in Antarctica, and then your deep water corals don't have to be in that 21 degree area. Here's your deep water coral banks. You have all heard about bleaching. This is what happens when the water temperature exceeds 1 degree Celsius for more than a few weeks. We've already lost, I think, 75% of our coral reefs. That's one number I've seen. I think there's several different numbers, and some of them are adapting. Are already figuring ways to change, but this is definitely a big problem. So basically, when it gets warmer, it starts kicking out its friends, kicking out the kids. They can't live there anymore, and then it becomes dead. So it's expelling the zooxanthella that live within its cells. Deep seafloor is the Earth's most uniform community. It's dark, it's very cold, it's slightly hypersaline. It's highly pressurized. There can be up to 4,500 organisms per square meter though, so it's not dead. They usually are slow creatures that have low metabolic rates. They're fragile. They tend to be very big, and they're special. They have specialized feeding and detection mechanisms. So this is all the blind creatures that have all kinds of bioluminescence. Some of them look like rocks. They have great sense of smell because they don't need their eyeballs. So here's some abyssal creatures. Here's a blind thumb-sized crustacean that almost looks like those skeleton shrimps we get. Sea slugs are pretty common. We get those hairy sea cucumbers around here that are pretty cool. We have brittle stars, not as many as we used to. We used to have tons of brittle stars. This is one way of creating food through magma and having little miniature volcanoes that create a chimney of deposition. And there are creatures that live there, like these tube worms. These live on hydrothermal vents, and they're using hydrogen sulfide for food. Here's a vent dominated by white clams. So when Alvin and stuff went down to look and discovered these hydrothermal vents that are either white smokers or black smokers, depending on the chemistry, they didn't think they'd find any creatures. And they're full of creatures. They're lined with very beautiful creatures. Each clam, each of these guys, is about the size of a shoe, and it contains chemosynthetic bacteria within its gills. Almost done. This is one of the ways that creatures live in little oases in the bottom of the seafloor. So you're swimming along the seafloor, there's not much food, you haven't seen a gas station for a while. You'll find what's called a whale fall. And we learned about these because we saw creatures that actually migrated from like Pacific Islands all the way to Japan or all the way to the west coast of America. And they would jump from whale fall to whale fall. And these are like little, on the highway, you've got your every 100 miles of rest stop. This is a big giant pile of carbon laying there in the cold waiting for decomposers and other creatures to eat them. And you've got a whole bunch of bacteria that have evolved just to eat these poor little whales that died and floated around, grossing us out for, you know, 2 or 3 months, and then eventually fell. Here's what one looks like, all of the eels and stuff swimming around it. So these are literally oases on the bottom of the ocean. To read more about whales, here are lots of different articles I've written about them. And I think that's it. Hey. So I'll go back, I'll take some questions, and I'll pull up one of those movies. Oh my gosh, it's 6:23. Okay, so we're good on time. So I'll pull up one of these movies and then take some questions. Let's see, which movie do we want to see?
Any reason why that brittle stars aren't around anymore?
Probably nutrient load. But we used to have, so the question was, why don't we have as many brittle stars? And I'm hoping that we might be able to do some directed research to that. Because we've been taking benthic samples for years, so has the town, so has SMAST and a lot of different groups. And we used to see tons of sand dollars, lots of brittle stars, and now we're seeing very few of those. Usually there's a change in, it's probably linked to the whelks. And to, you know, sometimes we will take the conchs or the whelks, sometimes we'll want, you know, there's the whole issue of whether whelks eat scallops and how many scallops they eat. So it's the balance between these different creatures. So I bet you a dime, dollar to a dime, that it's something to do with the whelk populations. It's probably also linked to the scallop populations and to a lesser extent to the stripers. So if you see a whole bunch of one creature, another creature is kept under control. So whenever we take a bunch of the whelks, we're seeing that with the green crabs and with the marsh crabs. When we change some of the top predators, they'll start proliferating. And so my guess is that it has something to do with that, but that's totally a guess. It could have been something where they weren't getting enough phytoplankton. Maybe they were getting hurt in dredges. God only knows. That's all speculation. But it used to be just you'd find buckets of them. When we would take a sample just about 10 years ago, I'd probably count 100 brittle stars in one bucket. And now we'll see one, typically. And we used to find a lot of sand dollars, which are groovy because they're very dark red velvet. You know, it's very different looking creature than when it's bleached and up on the seashore. And now you still see a few. I mean, how many have you, there's several people in here that dive. If you go snorkeling or diving, we'll do dive transects, as does Mariah Mitchell and the town, and you'll do a straight transect, and you'll count how many lady crabs and conchs and scallops are in that transect. So could be nutrient-based. It could be because we're having shading events. Could be all kinds of things, flow rate. You know, a lot of these creatures are very adapted to very specific currents and flow rates. Maybe they just got bored, I don't know. We also see a lot of creatures moving into deeper water because it's getting hotter and hotter. And that's true for the whole, you know, most of the world, temperatures are getting warmer. They're getting warmer in some in our harbor too. And that helps out certain creatures and it hurts others. So you'll see that these creatures are linked to temperature changes. Does it make sense?
Sandpipers eating where they run back and forth.
There's four or five different little clams and copepods and isopods and amphipods. I should have shown pictures of those that live in the beach, which are like little roly-polies. There's lots of different crustaceans that are all in that middle animal, you know, level. So they're pulling out those crustaceans. When we do benthic grabs in our biology classes, we'll take a grab of the sand and we'll put it through a sieve, and you'll find the polychaete worms, the blood worms, you'll find the peanut worms. There's all kinds of cool things. I mean, with your kids, all you have to do is take, you know, kids are always building sandcastles. Well, they'd be even more blown away if they took the sand and then put it through a fine little mesh. You could do it with cheesecloth and you would find all of these crazy creatures. Some of them are kind of shocking. We've got all kinds of stuff in there that live down almost a meter in depth. Some of them live very deep. In fact, we did that in our class last year. Even in February, you can still find some creatures that are in the sand, which is why it's, you know, I'm not a big fan of taking sand because people live there.
Do you make measurements of pH? Do you see the ocean becoming more acidic?
Yeah, the question was measurements of pH, and we do that in the harbor and of course, around the world. And pH is changed by 0.075 pH units worldwide. That doesn't sound like a lot, but that's a lot. That's the difference between, in fact, next week when I do the last class on our use and abuse of the ocean, I'll show some things that talk about how sea scallops and sea urchins, creatures that build their shells out of calcium carbonate and out of silicon dioxide, how that affects them. Some creatures can build their shells thicker and faster. Other creatures actually get thinner shells. Some things like sea urchins might be unaffected. But every kind of bivalve is affected by that. And we definitely see pH changes. The tricky thing in our harbor is algae will often raise the pH. So if you have a huge algae bloom, your pH will go, and it makes sense, right? You're creating all this miniaturized calcium carbonate, and we'll get pHs, ocean pH is normally 8.34. If we have a big algae bloom, it might get up to like 8.5, 8.6. So it's going to fluctuate, but long term it is getting more acidic, and we're seeing that in the weight of different creatures and how their shells. Things like mussels that have that mesentery have that little coating on the inside of them tend to be like ribbed mussels, and blue mussels are unaffected. Other bivalves tend to dissolve or have to put more of their energy into building their home. I equate it to if you're trying to build a house and someone comes and steals 5 bricks every day. You have to spend time buying bricks and putting it into your home.
What's worse, the temperature rise or the pH drop?
Well, they're partially linked. The temperature rise is worse for coral reefs. For bivalves, the pH drop is in areas where they have more flexible temperature regimes, then the pH is more effective for them, more of a problem. Each different habitat, I think for the mangroves, that the temperature is worse for mangroves, but each different habitat and benthic creature has bigger problems with one or the other. The problem is they're both happening. So they're both counterproductive. So their metabolic rate's higher already, but they're having to compete more. They're having to cool, you know, have to get to colder water. A lot of creatures, like I said, are running deeper into colder water. We're seeing a lot of economic species move off the coast and get into deeper water, even things like that torpedo ray like cold water. So they're going to get in deeper water. They might get out of the water where there's more krill. So everything's got all of these little factors that mess up their day. But I think it's different for each creature too. If you're just studying sea urchins, then the temperature might be more important than the pH. For other things like scallops, the pH might be more important than the temperature. That's a good question. That's a very good question. Yep.
You may have covered this, but I'm still puzzled why in the Antarctic, in the cold areas, there's so much more nutrient than in other areas.
There's tons more nutrients there, and there's much better recycling. Some of it's because it's shallower. It's because also we've got basically sand and dirt floating around the atmosphere, landing on the ice, and the ice actually traps all those nutrients. Ice has got fresh water, has nitrogen in it, has some phosphate in it. You've got all these seabirds pooping. You've got this basically upwelling all the time, so things aren't staying, you know, you don't have this temperature thermocline that's trapping all the good food below a thermal layer. So it's actually a really good question. If we had spent more time in looking at how oxygen and nutrients stratify in the ocean, you'll see that in the polar regions, there's more room for the nutrients to move up and down. They get exchanged much more frequently. And the ice is actually pretty important to that. One of the experiments that people did to try to fight climate change or to work with pulling out excess carbon is called the Iron X experiment or the Geritol experiment. And they actually spread iron in the Southern Ocean. And within 24 hours of dropping iron off a ship, they saw algae blooms in their tracks. So you could literally like reverse mowing. Tootling around and you're spraying iron, little tiny bits of iron behind you, and you'd have this green carpet grow behind you. So they're always, it's called a cold temperature, high level, high productivity, but it's always limited by the amount of nutrients. It's just a fast responder whenever any amount of nutrient is given to it. There's a whole other class I do that talks about each part of the ocean and how much nutrients and what the temperature is. But it's extremely productive. And it's what's strange, it really sunk home to me last February. I went out and there was tons, we did a phytoplankton tow and I'm like, oh my God, I've never seen so many. We had tons of copepods, it was bright green in 5 minutes of towing. I was shocked, and it was because it was a week like this week where it's really sunny. There's tons of stirring after a big storm. So all the nutrients were released from the sediments and things were growing like a kingdom come out there. It was really beautiful and really strange. Any more hands up that I don't see or see? Nope. Okay, we're right at, I'll put on a couple of these movies, but we're right at 6:30. Next week will be the very last one. And feel free to ask questions. I'll send out this PowerPoint to Amy tomorrow. Please make sure Amy has your email if you want to get copies of this PowerPoint. You can also directly ask me, and there's all kinds of cool things you can link on. This, when I'm doing it downstairs in the super duper room, I can have the PowerPoint on one screen and all of the movies on the other screen, but I haven't quite figured that out today. But especially look at those tenophores. If you watch that tenophore video or just Google tenophore videos, you'll fall in love with them. There's no way you can't. Thanks a bunch. See you in a couple weeks. Thank you.